Welcome to the, we're in February, not February episode of the Winchester NAC. I'm Kirk Barkin, the president of the group. Ken Pyle is the vice president. Daphne Wolf, secretary over there. Steve is absent today. And I don't see Barbara here today. Barbara's here, our treasurer. She's here usually. And Don, who volunteered to be our communication, he's kind of an acting role because he hasn't been to enough meetings to technically be a member yet, but he's out of town on personal business. But he has started to work on communications with us, so he was here at our last meeting, so we're excited to move that forward. We have, let me go through the agenda. So this is our agenda. We're going to try and stick to it. I'm not going to read through the entire thing. We're going to start with our board introductions, which I've done, and we have two guests that are here, Shireen from Mayor Liccardo's office. You'll see her, and you know Christina over at Chappie's office, and Jared over at Jack's office. Thank you, guys. Did I miss anybody else? Okay. So let's, from a business perspective, did everyone have a chance to review the minutes, or if they had any questions on the minutes from last week? If not, if someone wanted to make a motion to
move.
Okay, second, yes. Second. All right, any discussion, any questions?
Okay.
All right, so I'll call for the vote on approving the minutes. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? No. Great. Any new people here? I recognize, I think, every face. I don't think we have any newcomers to tonight's meeting. Anybody here for the first time? I don't think so. Okay. The info, WinchesterNAC.com, that was not functioning last meeting. It is functioning this week. This, as of last week, it is working. We tested it, and it does go to all board members. So if you want to reach us, info, WinchesterNAC.com goes to all board members, and so we can answer you directly. Anybody interested in attending another board meeting? They meet monthly. It's the first Sunday of the month, 4 o'clock. Just let me know, and I'll tell you the location. We can rotate the area. And are there any other items on the that we want to add to the agenda before we continue? Seeing none, we'll continue. Last time we talked about the vision, and we tweaked the vision yet again to remove vision from our vision because it seemed to be a little redundant. We appreciate that. So it actually tightens it up even more, and less on a vision, less is best is what we found, and we believe that this kind of summarizes the vision of the NAC, ensure quality of life and economic development in the Winchester region through innovation. Yeah, it's nice and tight. I think it's clear that we're focused on improvements that help us as a community, and innovation is a key part. And Shireen is with the office of, or the innovation area in the mayor's office, so we get a chance to actually approach her with some questions. State of the Valley Conference. This is a conference that was last Friday. A number of us from the NAC went to that. Just show of hands who went. Ken went, Daphne went, I went, Steve went, Christina and Jared went as well. A number of Chappie was there.
And Dave.
Dave was there. He was at our table. We had a table, and we felt whenever you go to something like this, it's important to kind of do a little bit of a book report on it, because this organization was funded in part by Chappie's office, so we want to serve your interests a little bit and pay back or give you some return on your investment there. So what I'll do is I'll take us through some of the slides, but I want to open it up to people that were there, Daphne or Jared or Christina or Ken, to chime in. But we tried to grab about a dozen slides. We're not going to spend a ton of time on any one slide, just to kind of breeze through them to show you some of the highlights. It was very interesting. Stefan Heck, I hope we get to have him come here and present. And if we do, we'll try and really get some cross-pollination people here. His vision on the state of where we are was really, I think, spot on. And his ideas on how to move forward, a majority of the slides you're going to see are actually from his presentation because they were so impactful. Henry Cisneros, he was from from HUD. He had some really candid things to say about our housing crisis and our lack of addressing that. And I think it was pretty eye-opening, some of the numbers. And then there was a debate between Newt Gingrich and George Miller, who's a former representative. And on the trademark, Michelle Lee, she spoke about, I think it was like 3-1 over any other city that has more trademark city in the country or some.
There's like 15% of the patents 50, in the country. Or
15% of the patents in the country come out of this area in San Jose, which is pretty impressive. So it was a really good panel. It was my first time I'd ever been to that. I think others have been to it before. It was a really interesting. It's put on by Joint Ventures, Silicon Valley. It's a nonprofit, and I don't remember the guy's name.
Who Russell Hancock.
Russell Hancock. Yeah, Russell. Really good speaker. Really fast paced. I mean, really kind of like if you've seen Don Wheaton, that kind of style. Really moves you through. So let's get to some of the. This is the just the view of the kind of the setup. It was probably about 1,500 people at the conference. Our table was kind of over here, so you're going to see when you see the slides, they're coming from the angle over here. So just bear with the angle when you see it, but you should be able to make it out. If you want to see any information about the organization, it's jointventure.org. Really interesting group that's focused on providing a lot of data. It's a really data-driven organization. This was a really interesting slide that we wanted to put up here. It shows the average. Now, this is the average. It's not the top one. It's not the bottom. It's the average. Silicon Valley, $122,000 is the average salary in Silicon Valley. Higher than San Francisco specifically. I mean, you know, it's almost 10% higher than San Francisco. And it's always double what the United States average is, 1.5 times what California's average is. So it's I think we all knew that there's a lot of wealth being generated here in the Valley, but to see it just kind of spelled out like that was pretty intense. And as I go through this, Daphne or Ken, just jump right in to add, and if I miss something, just again. This is, again, around the transportation guy, Heck, Stefan Heck. This is where Silicon Valley is headed from his perspective in its current trajectory if we don't do some significant changes. And I think a lot of people are living this today, depending on what time they go on the highway. So
where is it? Where was that?
I'm not sure where this one was.
It's just still a way in this problem. Well.
On both sides, so I don't think it was one, right? But the point that he was getting at is this is where we're headed, and the solution isn't just a bunch of these big transport buses. That doesn't solve our problems, which I think some companies in these centers are trying to do. Transport today, 99% waste, meaning if you look at, without spending too much time on this, and Ken, jump in if I misstep on this one, but the car is parked about 96% of its time. It just sits there, either in a parking space at your house, in a parking lot, or at the office. The fossil fuels that are burned in the gas engine, about 86% is wasted energy in terms of heat and gas and emissions. The throughput on the road is about 10% of the time is coverage, so we're not utilizing our arteries correctly. And he brought up the idea of Google or Apple or any of the autonomous cars can reduce some of the traffic fatalities and accidents that happen on the order of 90%. And so where are we? I think his provocative comments were, where is this playing in this problem that we're all living right now, and how are we embracing that? Any other?
Yeah, no. I think your next slide talks about accidents, right?
Yeah. So this is probably one of my favorite slides that he showed, and his presentation went into each of these sections. But just take a minute to just look at these, because the integrated network by distance, multimodal, cross jurisdiction. So it's not just one piece of transit. It's not just BRT on El Camino, or not just BRT on Stevens Creek. It's not just Caltrain. Convenience on demand with an app. So the Lyft, Uber, it's got to be convenient if we're going to try and solve some of these problems. Shared services, whether it's land, vertical stacking, with pedestrian access, and ground level vehicles are more valuable than parking. I don't remember how that tied into that. But this is the
parking takes a lot of land, right, that could be used for other purposes, I think.
And remember when we had Alan and Sharon speak about, kind of built environment and how inefficient we're utilizing our infrastructure and our technologies today and our land use, how much is being dedicated just to parking that isn't used most. frequency shift geo coverage to headway frequency. So this is an interesting perspective that he was mentioning. Rather than coverage geographically, how often does the vehicle arrive? So headwinds is the frequency. So you think of frequency, does the bus arrive every 5 minutes? Does it arrive every 45 minutes? And there are some braking numbers that if something is longer than 45 minutes, it's a throwaway. Nobody's going to use it. And he did a little poll. How long would you be willing to wait for your ride to show up? Or would you wait at a stop? And it was one of the choices was 5 to 10 minutes, and the majority of the audience polled 5 to 10 minutes. He said the average is about 7 minutes. If you mentally, we're all comfortable waiting about 7 minutes, give or take, and that's where your headwinds from your transportation needs to be able to arrive. If it's not within that 7 minute window, give or take, it's not going to be successful. That was really interesting. And then innovate, pay per use, new business, autonomy. How are we embracing those technologies that drive us away from car ownership? And then he goes into, this was a really interesting topic that he postulated that people are willing to drive to go to transit as long as the transit takes them to work. But they're less willing to have the take mass transit and then have to take another form of ridership to somewhere else where it becomes that much of a hassle. They're willing to take the hit up front, but not on the far side. So building transit near your destination is more likely to succeed in the analysis that he was doing, which I thought was really interesting. Is that what you guys took away as well?
Yeah, and also that works because you can essentially drive your car from your home to transit and then take transit to your workplace. But if you reverse it, then you have to leave your car, near your workplace so it doesn't work.
Right.
So I thought that was pretty interesting.
Yeah, it's a really interesting way to look at it because we're trying to connect everything all at once. But he basically was saying that you can get there, at least initially, if you solve half that problem at your destination. Younger people are not as interested in driving, and this
here ages.
Ages going down. Cars.
So and they're driving less. The younger they are, they're driving less. Like the 15 to 19 are driving less, 20% less in 2009 than they did in 1995, right? And so it's funny though, the elderly group are driving more now. 75 to 79, 80 to 84, 85 plus are all driving more, but the younger people are driving less. And I've seen this in other studies too. Millennials just don't have the same interest.
Yeah, my friend's kid just started CEQA University, doesn't even have a driver's license. Doesn't even want one, which I don't particularly agree with. You should at least have one, I think. But
that's bad. I'd be off the hop a bit, but I was younger, having a driver's license meant independence and freedom. What is it that's enticing younger people not to drive? What is their motivating force to be
The question was, why do younger generations not want a car?
Because I have an 18-year-old and I had forced to drive. and none of his friends drove. He was the only one that drove. It's too expensive for car insurance and to buy a car. Those are the main ones for them. They just can't afford it. And then if they live in an area where there's mass transit, it's just a lot cheaper and a lot more convenient. Not here. I mean, he said that I was his mass transit. That's another issue. But it really is the cost.
Yep.
But 20 years ago, it's not the same. Mom and dad would be the chauffeur.
Yeah, well, that's a cost.
Smartphone integration, it's allowed us to explore that. That just didn't exist 10 years ago, 5 years ago.
But your average 18-year-old, that's still expensive to lift or move compared to a bus.
Yeah, so the next slide, there's a slide coming up where we're going to talk about, there's a cost analysis here, quick cost analysis. This was an interesting slide that he put up. So this is a Cisco campus. I think it's a Cisco.
Yes,
right? Off of Tasman, right?
Cisco.
I recognize the shape, but I don't recognize that. But that must be Tasman.
That must be Tasman.
Tasman going down. That must be Tasman.
And that's Zanker.
And Zanker's over here, right?
Yeah.
So which holds more people, this or that one building?
The one building.
Right? Loaded question.
Yeah.
Right?
But it was also more environmentally.
something like that, and just think about all, you know, the land use. That's really to make you think about, you know, how can we use our land more effectively. Efficient use of space. Okay, this was cool. You might have seen this before. This was going around. I saw it on Facebook too. This is 40 people in a car, 40 people in a bus, 40 people on bikes, and how effectively the land is consumed by those modes of transportation. What's that one over there? What is that?
Seats.
Those little child seats or something? One's really dense and one's not. I'm not really sure what that means. But this is a real, I mean, to show you what 40 cars look like, you know, and how mass transit and then how individual pedestrians, how
that's parking the bikes, I think.
Oh, that's the parking.
40 bikes.
Oh, 40 bikes. Ah, there you go. Hey, nice. Like 40 bike parking. One car. So it just, you know, it is the scale is interesting. They also talk about e-bikes. Well, we'll get that. This is probably we're going to talk about this. This slide shows the trajectory on where kind of the break even point is from owning a car versus not owning a car, and how many miles you travel. Right, that's what this is for.
Yeah.
It's hard to read this one. That's about $4,500 or $4,600.
No, 4,500 miles.
Oh, I'm sorry, 4,500 miles. This is about 10. It's about 9,900. It's about 10,000 miles. This is about 13,000 miles, where the break-even points are for where it's more effective to use an Uber versus not using Uber. This one is a shared service, like. It's not Uber X, it's Uber.
Look one, that's when
it's Uber Pool.
Uber what?
It's Uber Pool.
Uber Pool. Like Uber Pool or Lyft Line, I think is the same concept. And Drive Now.
So Drive Now is a service by BMW. You basically hop in one of their BMWs, you drive it, and it's an electric BMW. You leave it somewhere, and then you go out doing your business, and then that's it. You just use it. You pay by the mile, it's like 12 cents a mile. So that's only up in San Francisco right now.
Right, and that's right, I forgot about that.
Yeah.
So the trajectories become more and more attractive as you start to have a shared economy. That's kind of what this is getting at. The more you can share the resources, the more scalable they become. This is a pretty depressing slide that shows fare box recovery and how effective our transit systems are versus others. Hong Kong, Taipei, BART, Caltrain, New York's Boston, and there's VTA pulling up the rear in terms of fare box recovery.
And you can draw a correlation with the density. Each one of the Hong Kong's the most dense, probably Taipei.
Well, there's also management too. The difference with Hong Kong.
BART's in here.
Yeah, Hong Kong is actually managed by a private entity. It's 75% owned by the government, but it's a private entity that also does management, building management. So they actually do the land use to drive demand for it, and they actually turn a profit. But so it is obviously the density is part of it. Part of it is because of the way they're creating the density.
And just to be clear, the delta between the 100 and here is taxpayer dollars.
What does the red line represent?
This is fare box recovery of highway spending.
So basically what it's saying is, no one who has a car wants to hear this, we're not paying enough to pay for the cars, right, that they're using the roads. We're not paying enough for the roads is what it's saying. But basically, we're
kind of subsidizing our road use.
Yeah, we're kind of subsidizing our road use is what it's saying.
Yeah, kind of get a free pass on our road use.
And I don't know what costs, you didn't dwell on what costs or didn't dive into what those costs mean, you know, what are in there and how does he count it? So that's the question, you know, is it really 45%? Is it 75%? What, you know, how is he measuring things? Is it cost to environment or whatever?
But I think the visual takeaway here is the yellows are things relevant to us, BART, Caltrain, VTA. These guys, it looks like they're paying, you know, able to pay their fair share, where VTA is just woefully not. I have two slides on this, two different perspectives, because this one, we'll come back to this one, but this shows how all of these services kind of connect. If you have shared services, electric with more efficient uses of the technology that you have, having connected, integrated connected ways so you can make sure your drop-off points are timed correctly, and autonomous vehicles, all these things together, he called it
pieces. Autonomy, connected, shared, and electric.
Oh, there you go. Yeah. And it gets down to 8 cents a mile. When stuff like that happens, then the car becomes kind of a joke. And why would you want to own one other than just for recreation? It's not. It doesn't become a business critical tool anymore. And that was probably the biggest point that I walked mm-hmm. away with. Is it becomes very attractive not to have a car and incenting that way rather than mandating stuff. Okay, so that was those are the slides that we had from the conference. Are there any other things that you guys took away? Those are just things that we kind of correlated. But are there any other?
So I wrote an article about it that you guys can read about, and that's why that whole thing about the I was really curious about the Hong Kong thing. How are they doing it? And so I have the links to that kind of stuff in there, and so it kind of gave an overview of the conference. One of the takeaways was actually from Newt Gingrich, and he suggested that this valley take 2 or 3 spots and make them models for the rest of the United States as to how to innovate. And it isn't necessarily technology innovation, although that's part of it, but innovate as far as regulation, getting figuring out how to be this next generation city. And that was my takeaway, is maybe we could be that area. We've got Campbell, we've got Santa Clara, we've got San Jose. If we could figure out a way to kind of streamline between those 3 different jurisdictions, that would be a huge deal, I think. So that was my takeaway.
Sure, great. Yeah?
I think my biggest takeaway it was all around the transportation. The other stuff was interesting. This was the most interesting and innovative part for me. But hearing that we had 38 different transportation districts in the Silicon Valley, or in the Bay Area, and they don't really operate together, and there's no connections between them. And then looking at all of the different, that there was just that one graph about BTA, but they have this other picture up that was that Beijing and us were building a transportation system at the same time. They have 9.4 million riders a day, and we have 30,000 a year. And I mean, it's staggering to think that we didn't, and it's not us, but we're dealing with it now. We didn't plan for the future. And we seem to be still going down the same track that we were. There's little bit pockets of innovation with BTA, but it's not enough. There's not enough interagency coordination. And this excited me and depressed me all at the same time.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, totally. And just so you guys know, BTA is probably going to ask you for another half cent at the till, sales tax, so they can start funding all their holes in their organization. So just think about that, how well they've done so far, if you want to continue to fund something. So just, this is your money. It's our money. So
the third increase also, right?
Yeah.
The third increase to ask for.
Well, one of the issues somebody mentioned in one of the meetings is BTA's leadership is governed by people who rotate in and out. By the time they even barely come up to speed, their term's over and somebody else is replacing them. I think San Jose has more votes than any of the other cities.
They have 5.
Some of the cities are so small they probably...
They rotate in and out.
You wonder whether they should have a vote, but, it's the only regional game in town. So we're stuck with it unless we come up with a better model.
Yeah, unless we can help push them in a direction that we, anyway, that's something to think about and what's affecting us. Jared, any takeaways from your perspective that you want to...
No, I think you covered everything well. It was a very interesting presentation. So it doesn't surprise me about BTA fare recovery. I've driven light rail, fairly frequently. The system...
Must be lonely on light rail, huh?
And the system's not structured to capture fares. And I don't know. I'm always paying for mine, but I don't think, when I'm on a train, I think anyone else does. So.
I really enjoyed this concept of spaces and just imagining all these different modes of transportation and just being able to hop on them and have it all connected like a puzzle to get where you want to go. Which, like you were saying, it's inspiring and hopefully, not necessarily having to wait for this complete infrastructure overhaul, but really getting these pieces and that can eventually fit together. So I really enjoyed how the put this all together.
Mm-hmm. Really, really thorough job. Yeah.
Did they bring up high-speed rail at all?
I don't think so.
No.
Good point. I don't even think people thought about it.
Electric bicycles came up.
Yeah, electric bicycles is a really big deal.
I was really surprised how much. Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
Did they compare apples with apples when it comes to the square footage or the acreage? Maybe VTA can't do as good a job as Taipei or some other place. It has, you know, 1 million people per square mile, and we have 500,000 or a lot less. So I'm just curious if they did any analysis that way.
I don't think apples to oranges.
Apples to oranges.
And again, I researched some of the stuff because I didn't necessarily. Were there really 9 million
riders?
But you know what? I looked it up and Beijing had 9 million. You'd think Beijing? I've been there. You'd think it would be a lot more dense than San Jose. Turns out, the whole Beijing municipality is. It's about 2,000 people per square mile versus San Jose is about 5,000 square people per square mile. But it's also a 6,000 square mile area. So it's an area almost as big as the Bay Area, right? So I'm sure it's dense and not dense. And there are miles of track. They've got about 10 times the number of track. They've laid about 344 miles of track in the last 14, 15 years. They really started building this in 2002. They had like one line they built before that in 1969. So they, amazingly enough, it wasn't as different as you would think in Beijing. The difference was frequency. And he said this, that they were 2 minutes and 5 seconds versus 15 minutes for the VTA. And that was the biggest thing that drove ridership, was that you could get it and go, right? You didn't have to wait 15 minutes or something, right? And it was, so I think that was part of it. But I think the density stuff starts to go away if you can come up with these other last mile things. And that's where the e-bikes come in handy. They'd done some modeling with e-bikes. And my thinking was, well, what about the rain? What about safety and that kind of stuff? And he pointed to cities like Copenhagen, where you intentionally build so you can have bikes and e-bikes and stuff. But also, his modeling took into account that you'd have wimpy people who would, like in this weather, would take Lyft or Uber. So he factored that in as the cost. And we have this, I don't know if we have the slide.
I didn't put that in there yet.
But it shows about 7 miles, I think it was, you would actually be better off with an e-bike commute-wise because it would be less time because you wouldn't be stuck in all that traffic. So, and it would be a lot cheaper. Cost-wise, it was maybe a fifth the cost of the car. Like $1,000, and then the cost of electricity.
My neighbor just got an e-bike, and he let me ride it. It's really cool to ride. I mean, you go really fast. And he goes from Williams Road to NVIDIA over by...
Yeah, Santosham.
If he took Santosham Expressway with his car, it takes him 23 minutes. But with his e-bike, he can do it in 17 minutes. He doesn't go on the expressway. He takes... So it's faster on an e-bike. He takes the pedestrian tunnel. He's the guy who wrote the little message today about the homeless.
I didn't verify this, 250 million e-bikes sold in China. Now, I don't know if that's a potential market or what, but I do know at CES, I was there last month, and e-bikes and variations of e-bikes were everywhere. Little electric motor scooters, little personalized, three-wheel motorcycles that are covered and stuff.
Yeah.
So I think there's some changes that we're on the cusp of that could really, that whole last mile thing, the density thing kind of changes, right? Maybe you just need feeder lines for the longer distances.
Oh, just aside from density and frequency, though, and Jared and I were talking about this after the convention, and that when you compare different cities and different countries, you also have to factor in the cost of building the infrastructure. Mm-hmm. And I don't say this in a way of diminishing the possibility of it, but just realistically that you have to, Jared brought up, you have to pay fair wage in the U.S., and you also have CEQA, which we're talking about, and regulations that slow the process down and make it more expensive. So when you compare to different cities, it's inspiring, but also recognize it's going to be a different process, different timeline, different cost.
Well, another big issue, though, is the safety issue, because if you've got these great big, trucks going down the street, I don't want to be on this little bike.
Right. Not unless you're protected. Now, Shiloh talked about that at the WAG meeting a couple times ago. She talked about different ways to outline streets and how to reclaim parking to turn into bike lane safety. And
yeah, and I don't think he was advocating rail either necessarily, because I mean that's the thing, it puts you in a fixed infrastructure, whereas moving from time division multiplexing electronics to packets, right? And fundamentally, that's a lot more efficient, and that's what cars are, right? So, but the problem is you've got 99% of that car is wasted pushing metal around, right? When really, you know, it's 200 pounds we're pushing around instead of 2,000, right? We only need to push us, you know, people moving, not relevant.
Yeah.
I wanted to just go back to the BTA tax that they're proposing. I think we have to be careful to find out what they actually are proposing to use that with, because I don't think that we should just dismiss it out of hand because we don't like the way that they've spent the money before, or we don't know how they've spent the money before. I think that it's really important for us to do our due diligence and the possibilities. Or is that just an open, is it an open tax that goes into the general fund to fund everything? I think we have to do research on that first.
There's already some initial, you know, large portion would be in Bart to San Jose to complete final mile or final, you know, stretch from it would go toward pavement maintenance. I mean, there's different, it's already kind of broken into different structures already. Not everything is some would go to transit, a lot would go to Bart, a lot would go to local cities, not pavement maintenance.
Point well taken. We should know all the data before we draw conclusions. Yes.
I just was thinking on the end where you're talking about the older people being driving. Our future as seniors and the largest population growth that's going to be happening, so there'll be more and more of us driving. And we'd rather not drive to get to a doctor, to get groceries, to get errands run. We'd rather have somebody pick us up timely, get us there, and get us back. Now, that's going to be the issue. My walker won't fit on an e-bike.
No, that's right.
And many of us are in wheelchairs. And that is an issue that needs to be addressed. Was it even addressed?
Well, yeah, I would say with the autonomous e-taxi, as Alan mentioned the other day, right? In our email exchange.
Yeah.
With the laundry truck.
The e-bike, I don't think, was meant to be the thing that solves the problem. It's a way to help contribute to the solution. Yeah. It's just another mode. And by no means was it, we're not going to put everybody on bikes and send them around. But the autonomous vehicle discussion will help provide that level, I think, that level of independence and mobility that everybody's going to ultimately need. And it's just a matter of how to, what are we doing? And when we get to Shireen, we're going to probably press. I know I'm going to ask a couple of questions. So we'll get to that. But I want to keep us moving along here because I want to keep us on schedule. We have a couple guests. So we're going to start with some quick updates. Daphne had to leave, so I'll just touch on that on this briefly. But let's start with Ken with fiber. Oops. Yeah.
Okay, so I'll be real quick here. We've been looking at this since last February. I started thinking about this when Google originally passed over San Jose. I have a lot of friends out in the rural Midwest who have cooperatives that are basically broadband networks owned by the people who live there. So it's an old-time cooperative. So we've had a couple of meetings, probably about 30 of us or 40 of us. I haven't looked at the total number, not all at one time, but at various times. So what we're looking at is creating a broadband network that is fast, affordable, and controlled by the community. That's the kind of vision that we came up with as a group. And the idea is really to border, to follow the WNAC. And I actually mapped out just the southern part of it. I never got to the northern part, north of 280. And there's about 35 miles of roads here in this little area, about 6,300 homes. I think about 16,000 people. Actually, we looked at the economics. Do you have the... So what we're looking at is something that's truly fiber to the home. So it's future-proof, gigabit, download, upload, can migrate to higher than that. $52 to $76 a month, and that depends on how many people we can get involved. Like I said, we've got a 20-page kind of model of this. I think the key thing is it gets back to that control. That's the price. We don't want to, you know, be like these things where you get the promo pricing and then the next thing you know, 12 months later, you're paying $200 when you started with $50. And so it's the whole idea of being jerked around, not knowing what your privacy is like. So the question is, look, it really is that target customer of someone who is really, you know, wants the local ownership, the management, isn't, you know, doesn't have a problem with creating their own bundle. If they just get broadband, they can get telephone service from Vonage or 8x8 or whoever, and they can get video from, if they want DirecTV or maybe Sling TV. There's options out there, and there's going to be more and more options out there for getting TV just directly over the internet, so you don't have to have this huge bundle. Now, it's not going to be easy. As I started the conversation, I said, Google passed us over. Well, then later this year, they came back and said, we're here. And I guess they've been working in the background in San Jose and
Santa Clara, too.
And Santa Clara, and probably Campbell and other places. But back to Christina's comment about the CEQA document, and as I understand it, the 250-page or 225-page document I read wasn't even a CEQA document. It was just justification why a CEQA document wasn't needed. And actually, what I did read in it was, you know, other people can use this document if they wanted to use the broadband network, because it basically goes through the whole city of San Jose and looks at places like where there might be burrowing owls. I think over by 87 there was an issue. And over here, there really isn't anything. There's no historical Indian burial grounds or anything like that. So that actually kind of said, well, maybe this is worth looking at. And if we get enough people, why don't you click it? I didn't have it on there, but if we had about a 20% of the people saying, yeah, we want to do this, and we'll commit the money to do it, to actually do the build, we might be able to pull it off. And so, you know, it's still very early. I need to finish the survey. We need to finish that. And then the idea was we'd do a crowdsource campaign, something like, you know, if you're interested in doing this, put up $100, because if we get enough people, then what we'll do is we'll actually form the cooperative, do the detailed engineering, which has been very cursory at this point, and see if it works out. So that was it. So if you're interested, I think the easiest thing to do is, if you sign in, just put an F next to your name on the way out. So remind me to mention, all right, guys, pass this around now. So, and if you've already, like Pat, I know, is already in there, and obviously her, so I'll just...
Is this a fiber cable to our house?
Yeah, fiber to the house. In fact, we're going to inject it directly into you. So if you don't need a TV anymore, there'll be fiber right to the Wi-Fi. It's an innovation that I didn't really want to
add. Is it $50 a month going to pay for putting in fiber cable?
Yeah, so $52 to $76 is what, you know, in that range, right? Oh. So that's the idea, is that about $24-$26 of that was the cost of your portion of the network. And again, it depends. We have to get a critical mass. There's probably about 1,200-1,500 people.
But you're going to use someone else's fiber, right?
We would own that last mile fiber. Yeah, and then that would connect. Actually, so I found two sources of fiber backbone, and Zio Broadband has fiber. Well, yeah, you probably saw them next door. There was a bunch of complaints about Zio Fiber, Zio Broadband going through people's backyards. They're connecting up schools, actually cell towers. They're doing a lot of cell tower backhaul. They don't do residential. They do this other stuff. So they have fiber kind of going around. So we would hook onto theirs, and that would take us downtown to the Gold Building, where we'd hook into a Hurricane Electric. But then we built this last mile fiber into the home.
So that would be the total cost, $50 to $75, or we have to pay also to the cable company?
No, that would be the total cost. So that includes. So in there, and I didn't put the details because we only had 2 minutes on this, but that's okay. But the idea was to subcontract out things like the billing, the regulatory
maintenance,
and so there's some of those are embedded in that. We figure that's about $36 a month. The big one, the variable one, is the cost of the network, right? And that will, to a large extent, depends on how many people sign up for it, right? And then it does become a commitment. Ideally, we would put this as part of the property, so then you could just transfer it if you sell your property. But you have a question.
Why do you don't live in the Winchester NAC?
I live in the
It really depends on people. It's neighborhood by neighborhood.
Well, what's right? The northeast street
there? Up here. Oh, we have Brewers.
NAC was the boundary of that.
Wires around my house?
No.
Well,
that's a big deal. Is it like it goes under the ground?
Well, it'd be either on the same pole as the existing wires.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. You already have a wire coming into your house, right? Either electric wire or telephone. Yeah. You have a telephone wire?
Yeah.
So this is cable
wire?
That.
No cable.
Yeah. So you have a telephone wire?
Telephone.
Okay. So yeah, you would have to have one more wire. A very thin wire, but yeah, one more wire.
Yeah, and that'd be the big question is do you go underground with all the thing, which would be pretty cool, but it'd be much more expensive.
A little more expensive.
The first place that you look at, it looks like old India.
Yeah, this is terrible. Wires are terrible.
Yeah, no, and actually the underground is something that we would be interesting to talk to Google about, see if they want to partner in that shared trench.
Yeah, that's a big deal.
And one of the things I've emailed to Con is that we need to have a dig once policy in San Jose, so when we dig it up, we'll be able to do it. Anyway.
Yeah. Well, it sounds interesting, so. Yeah, just one.
Oh, go ahead, Pat.
One add-on. Just in the past 2 weeks, my son and I are starting, you know, we have the four different homes that we have been paying telephone bills and internet service, and now we are, we've discontinued our telephone bill by putting in Google Voice for free.
Oh, yeah.
Two lines for free. It pops onto our existing internet, so I'm saving about $40 a month on the phone charges that I used to be paying for, you know, because I had like voice and fax. I don't have to pay that anymore because it's all free now with Google. And I'm just using the internet. So it's a nice little savings.
I use Google Voice too.
Yeah.
All right. Our next person is, I don't mispronounce your last name. I'll let you in.
So my name is Shireen Santosham, and I just joined the mayor's team as the chief innovation officer, which is a new position in the city. So you're probably kind of wondering what it is that we actually do. And so, you know, it's so great to be here with all of you, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to engage with you. And I love the discussion about the future of transport. And one thing, before I sort of introduce myself and go into things, one thing that is really exciting that we did recently is the Department of Transport here in San Jose applied for a national grant.
Oh, yeah.
So Fox, who's the Secretary of Transportation at the national level, issued a grand challenge, basically, where they're going to award $40 million to one city in the United States to basically test all of these cool infrastructure projects. And then Paul Allen up in Seattle, the co-founder of Microsoft, is going to match another $10 million on top of that. So we're in the runnings for that. It's very competitive. 77 cities in the United States applied. And so we'll find out in mid-March if we make it to the top five.
How many of you have a Winchester NAC that has innovation?
Yes.
I mean, I'm just saying.
Well, and actually, you know, the innovation vision that you've laid out, I think, is a lot to do with what the role is that the mayor is building out in this office, right? So how do we think about using technology and innovation to make the city work better? How do we deliver services more efficiently? How are we more user-centric? How do we think about the future, take advantage of where we are? And I know there's a lot of frustration around feeling like other cities are doing this better than San Jose has been able to do. And so, you know, the hope is that we can both replicate and learn from other cities, but also really leapfrog because of where we are, because we have residents like all of you, and really get to a place where we're the most innovative city in America in the next 5 years. And so that's sort of the grand vision. I joined the team about a month ago, so we are at the beginning of this journey. And I come from a background where I worked on mostly mobile technology. So I worked on a lot of public-private partnerships on sort of big scales. So I was working with GSMA, which is the big mobile phone industry association internationally, and I worked on digital access issues for poor women globally. So I looked at the digital divide between men and women because there's a lot of cultures in which, you know, women don't have the same rights and access as we do enjoy here. service delivery, efficiency, reduce costs, and provide an excellent customer experience. And so that's, you know, sort of our big goal. So, you know, what are those drivers like? You know, I think one of the things that is very obvious now is that we're not just talking about innovation for innovation's sake. So there are these very real pressures. So there's, you know, traffic, there's growth in the city that's going to cause some real pressures that if we don't adopt some of these technologies, we'll be in a world of hurt. So that's, I think, where the conversation is around the autonomous vehicles. I think there's also a citizen expectation. So, I mean, now that you have Uber and you can click on your phone, you know, one click and have a car show up and you get that level of service, and then, you know, you go to a government office and then you have to do something on paper, it just doesn't quite fit, right? And so I think, you know, our citizens are demanding this as well. So what are the things that we can do in order, what are the tools at our disposal? I mean, at the end of the day, technology is just another tool. And I think some of the things that we are looking at is, you know, how do we digitize existing services? How do we crowdsource data collection to be more efficient? How do we digitally enable new information? And how do we also, like, think about using more visualization, big data analytics? And how do we optimize operations? Right? Because some of these things are not actually technology issues, they're process issues. So what are the ways that we can actually implement this? The first is, you know, we're really focusing on innovative partnership models. So I sit in actually the Office of Strategic Partnerships. The mayor's created a place where we can actually partner effectively with the private sector, but also with a lot of other stakeholders that that you wouldn't necessarily think about. So, for example, we're part of initiative. So that's an initiative where you have over 100 cities in the United States and abroad who share their learnings and what they're doing around the world so that you can build capacity around certain things like open data. You know, and open data, I think, is a really big opportunity. So open data, we're bringing an open data policy to the council in mid-March. I think March 15th is when it will be brought to council. And what that, you know, I'll talk a little bit about what's in that open data policy, but open data is there's a transparency imperative around it. It also creates an ability for the private sector to then use that data in new ways, allow citizens to engage in new ways. And so we're starting to get very serious about open data. And then I think, you know, the last thing is that there's a really strong political commitment around this. So the mayor, the council members, including Councilmember Jones, have been very supportive of these initiatives, and so I think this is the right time for some of these changes. So I'll talk about some of the initiatives that we have going on now. I will caveat it by saying we are early in this process, and there will be more good things to come. But the sort of priority initiatives that are happening right now are around, you know, first, build this Office of Innovation, right? So that's, you know, me in on the mayor's side, but also thinking about building an Office of Innovation in City Hall so that we have a team there that can actually go and work and implement, because we're mostly on the policy side. The second is this open data policy and actually an open data platform. It's actually a portal where there's just a one-stop shop that you can go and get all of the information on city data. And we've published some data sets on that, but we're still at the beginning. There's over 600 data sets that will eventually be published, but that's, you know, every possible thing you can find in the city. We have something called a neighborhood dashboard that we're building, and we are doing this in partnership with San Jose State University. And the concept is that you'll be able to go, you'll basically have a dashboard of everything you care about in your neighborhood. So everything from, you know, air quality to crime to traffic, and that you'll have sort of a real-time ability to sort of press and see what's going on, you know, what buildings are getting built in your neighborhood. And that's that's, you know, we're in sort of the MOU phase with the university, but that will get worked out over the next year. So we're kind of scoping, you know, tidying up the scope and working with the professors on that. Because, you know, for the university, for us, we have sort of a direct implementation challenge. For the university, they also have sort of experimental and research agenda, so they also want to test certain, like, new ways of doing things from a technology perspective. The next thing is we are in the process of building a Mayor's Innovation Fellows Program. So, as you know, one of the issues with local government is that you simply can't pay to attract the kind of talent that you might, you know, always want to attract. And so the Innovation Fellows Program is a way that people can sort of volunteer and maybe get some compensation, and we're also working with different universities in the Valley to figure out if we can get more summer fellows or student fellows. Right now we actually have some really engaged citizens who just want to work with us and are doing fellowship projects on their own time. One of them, you know, he recently came from Google Fiber. We have another who's doing data analytics on traffic patterns and figuring out hotspots of where we have traffic fatalities. And then we have these sort of a long list of partnerships that is enabling us to do a lot of this work. And so I'll give you, I know there's going to be a lot of interest in, especially the partnerships with the private sector. But I think that the one that's coming up, and I really unfortunately can't talk a lot about it at this point because it's not fully public, all the details of it, is that we actually have a partnership that will result in free high-speed internet access for different parts of the city, as well as a community benefit part of that, which will go to traditionally under service parts of the city. So, you know, the company that we're working with will provide, you know, free gigabit Wi-Fi to a big, pretty big portion of the city. And so that'll be public in the next couple months.
Yeah, any idea for be around this area, too?
Does it start with a G?
I would love to come back and talk to you about it if we have the opportunity to do that. But we're under, you know, pretty strict NDAs.
I think Mayor Liccardo mentioned that KLIB. He didn't obviously give detail. Yeah, any more detail than you just have.
Yeah, but unfortunately we just can't. But it will be public soon, and then we'll be very excited to talk about it with everyone. The next one is Transportation Innovation Zone. So there's one that's currently going to be piloted in North San Jose, and it will be an area where they can test things like autonomous vehicles and different kinds of sensors. And so we're in the concept phase for this Transportation Innovation Zone, and hopefully in, you know, this would be the first one, and hopefully, you know, we could do more. Because I think there's a real sense that, you know, we need to figure out what new transportation is going to look like, because it's not going to look like it does today. And that's pretty clear.
That's working with VTA in that zone, or?
I think this is more.
San Jose Central.
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. This is the event, not involving VTA. And then I think, you know, we don't have any official partnerships yet on sort of crowdsourcing apps, but there is a really big opportunity around things like, you know, Waze data to partner with the city. So, you know, for example, Waze has a program where they partner with cities, and you can feed in city data around where construction is happening around the city, so that when you're driving around, you know where construction is happening, which is not happening today unless people sort of self-report. So there's a more structured way to do that, and then we can also get data from them, and that can help us with some of our traffic.
On the waste thing, I was wondering, I've been thinking about this a lot, is it possible, now that you have some communication with them, like the street that I live on, I'm pretty sure Waze is directing people down. I'm serious. Because it's a bottleneck on Winchester, I've seen a big increase in traffic.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you can pick up the phone and call Waze and tell them to turn off the road, that'd be okay with me.
Well, I think it's a really good point, which is, you know, with these new technology applications, there's a lot of unintended consequences around them, right? So I'm sure that Waze probably wasn't thinking about that consequence. And I think it's important to start to have those dialogues.
Another thing that you mentioned, this last meeting that we had here, San Jose, and he put out all these things that you could do to leverage. San Jose is, I guess, the only city in the United States that has decoupled from the utility company with the streetlights. I don't know if you're aware of that, but that's a powerful thing that you could really leverage off of. The whole streetlight infrastructure is able to do a bunch of things with technology and innovation. But it could really make us leap. You're talking about leapfrog.
Sensors on lots of city infrastructure, and then big data and analytics, and then there's a piece about sort of traffic management, autonomous vehicles. But you know, the autonomous vehicles aren't things that we'll do ourselves. Those are really about how do we leverage the private sector. Great. So I think there's a couple other partnerships that I wanted to highlight too that we are involved in that I don't think we've probably done the best job of sharing with our residents. So I mentioned the DOT grant, which was the third point. But the other two that we are already a part of is one is the MetroLab network through the White House. And what the MetroLab network does is it looks at partnering universities with cities to come up with, like, let's not just sort of replicate what we have today, but let's really think about the innovations of the future. And so we are, a MetroLab network city, so we have a relationship with the White House, and we have a relationship with this is our San Jose State University partnership. But it also allows the MetroLab network and the Bloomberg What Works initiative both allow for a lot of cross-city pollination. So, for example, yesterday we hosted a study session for our city council, and we had representatives from three other cities around the country that are doing really innovative work. So one was South Bend, Indiana. We had the mayor speak who has done sensors on his sewer system to basically optimize the infrastructure and save the city $100 million through using sensors smartly. The other person we had was Amin Mashariki, who's the head of data analytics for New York City. And he, I've known him for a couple of years, and they're just doing incredible work around small businesses. They are way ahead of us in terms of they've been at this for over 10 years because, Mayor Bloomberg had started this way back in the day. But one thing that they're doing is they are mapping every plot in New York City, and you can actually click on it, and it tells you all of the permitting, zoning issues for that building. It tells you, what the population demographics are in that area. They used a startup to put sensors all over the city that actually manage foot traffic. So if you're thinking about starting a new business, you say, oh, well, here's actually the foot traffic that I'm going to get. And so they are very late years ahead of us and where we are today, but I think, being able to see a city that's able to do those kinds of things is very empowering. And then the last group that we had come in and talk was San Francisco, our neighbor, who have also been at it for a long time. They have a very advanced innovation fellows program that they've leveraged very well. They also are very good about working with startups. So they have a startup in residence program. And some of the innovative things they've done around procurement to make it easier to do city business is also interesting. So that's all to say we are learning from, the best around the country. And we have a lot of support from organizations like the White House. Bloomberg What Works focuses more on open data and big data analytics and helping us to get to a best practice where we are both balancing sort of transparency around our data, messaging that data, so how do we think about visualizations, and then how do we balance sort of like privacy and other public safety concerns. And then the last thing, I mentioned the study sessions which had these three cities, and the last thing I'll mention is something I'm not directly working on, but another member of my team is working on, is how do we think about closing the skills gap. So we all are concerned about inequality, we see what's happening in the Valley. And Tech Hire is another initiative out of the White House to basically skill up people who don't have four-year college degrees, but skill them up in technology so they can get tech jobs. And the goal is to, I think, 400 jobs, actual jobs, and people placed in the next just, you know, makes sense. It's not a big lift for us, and it's a big benefit for them, and we're saving some money.
Any idea when that will be closed, the RFP?
I think it's going to be closed in the next 3 months.
Okay.
So I have a quick question on the lights again. We heard a couple things. One is that putting anything on those lights is very challenging with PG&E because of regulating costs or like energy being consumed, etc. But the other thing was is that the RFP that was put out there seemed to, and the speakers said maybe it's not quite this drastic, but it seemed that it was really focused on cost recovery and only saving city money to replace the sodium, whatever they are, high pressure, with LED, and that saves the city by, you know, $3 million a year, or $10 million, whatever it is, which is great, but it seemed to miss the opportunity that actually touching the, you know, the labor to do that was actually doing.
Yeah.
And so how is, from your perspective, how is that correlating to what's actually happening? Like, is that true? Is it, can we not put stuff on it without these special month-long negotiations with PG&E? Is there a way to deal with that, or what are you hearing about?
Yeah, so to be honest, this project was happening before I joined. So the folks who are working on it, I don't have that level of detail on what the negotiation looks like. But I do think to the point on how do we become more strategic, right? So like dig once, or how do we think about this beyond just cost savings, is something that we're pushing on now. So I think before we didn't have the capacity. My role is new, and we didn't have someone who was looking at sort of a more strategic approach, and it was more based on individual projects. So what I would say is that a lot of the initiatives we've done so far have been project-based, and now we want to go more programmatic and more strategic and start to think about the future, right? And I won't say that, some of that stuff won't still happen, but I think there's more of a recognition of the need to be strategic. Have you talked about this before, the sensors that we're testing?
I don't think so.
No. Okay.
Yes,
sir. Yeah, so we're testing some connected infrastructure already. I think we're sort of in the initial stages of it. So one, I'll talk about the bottom one first. So Cisco, we're testing a DSRC system, which is basically like internet for cars, and you put like part of it on a telephone pole, you put part of it, and there, a lot of the cars will have this, and it can help manage, create a network. That's sort of the spine by which you then can put the sensors on top of it, which is the top part of the RSM that we're looking at, different kinds of traffic patterns. So there's a lot of data that's going to come out of this. So this is like broadly Internet of Things, connected infrastructure piece. And the thing about this kind of data is it will really help us think about how do we optimize systems, right? So it's really more about, once you have all this data, can you do predictive analytics around how to optimize the system and then figure out where there might be issues. And there's probably, frankly, lots of applications that we don't know about. So eventually making this data open will allow entrepreneurs and others to really think through what is possible.
Is that going to be up in that transportation innovation zone then?
Yeah.
And how does something become a transportation innovation zone?
So I think it was designated a while ago. I think part of the reason why it was up there is because I think a lot of the businesses are located around there. Cisco is close by there. But I don't know actually how it was designated, because I wasn't there.
If there's a way just to find out what the process is, and if the, that'd be great.
Yeah, I think it's a new thing. Sorry.
Well, I'm just wondering, standard new cars after 2017, is that going to be like a federal mandate, or...
Yeah, it's
going to
be
separate. Yeah, Cadillac's coming out with the first one this year, the first model on the map. But it also could communicate to traffic lights and things like that, right? So eventually, you wouldn't even need visual signals, conceivably, right?
Yeah.
Well, will it be able to not just be, predictive analytics, but can it change? I mean, it sounds like the traffic light infrastructure and light infrastructure, these are disparate systems. They're not in any way connected. Is the goal, or what I would offer as a hopeful goal, would be to have those be where the timing of those lights don't get programmed every month or every year, but then it can be a real-time analysis. So if there's one area that's clogged up, it starts to change things.
Yeah.
That.
I think that's right. I think that's where eventually we would want to go. The sort of abilities that are increasing around machine learning and AI eventually will be able to make that a living system. I think the challenge, I think we're so far away from that, partially because there is a lot of fear around losing that control, right? So the process by which that happens.
Yeah. Who's fearful of that?
I think that internally there are fears within from city staff, right? Around, I mean, what if someone is able to hack into our system and mess with our traffic lights, right? I mean, there's a legitimate fear there. And so how do you think about that process? And then I think there's probably fears. You all are very forward-leaning residents, but there's probably fears from other residents as well. So the process of how we do that in being experimental and staging that in is something that we would work with DOT on. But I imagine it will be, several years. So now I want to talk a little bit about this open data policy that I mentioned before. So open data basically means that all of the city data is open by default. So right now you can have a public records request for, any data in the city, but it's not really open in a, easy to use format, easy to understand. And so a lot of cities have had open data policies. We have not yet. And so we have drafted one. It'll be coming to council. And it will essentially make all data that's not confidential or there's not some serious concern about that the city has, and protecting people's privacy, all the rest of the data will be available. Right? And that'll be staged in over time. But we're going through sort of a prior registration process about which data sets will be released and how. And we'll also have this sort of one-stop shop, which is this open data portal. You get all of that data together. I think...
So is it more than a policy, though? It's APIs and stuff like that, so people can just tie into it.
Yeah, because we want it to be available for coders and other people who want to grab it, but we also want it to be available for citizens, right? So one of the things we're trying to think through is which visualizations do we need? Because a lot of I hosted the town hall a couple weeks ago with about 100 nonprofits, and one of the things that they were saying is data in that format isn't necessarily good for us. We don't have the resources to process it, right? So we're working with them to try and figure out, here are the visualizations that would be most helpful so that they can care about better. And then I think we're piloting a couple of big data analytics projects. So one of them is around Vision Zero, which is the goal to have zero traffic fatalities in San Jose. And this project has been quite cool. So it's identified 14 hotspots of where most of the fatalities happen. And so what it allows you to do is say, rather than doing sort of blanket initiative on every street corner, it helps you understand which corridors and why are you facing sort of higher stage traffic fatalities. Most of them are actually where highways meet streets, right? So you might have a bicyclist hill that way. And then, a lot of it is around what came up is a lot of it is caused by jaywalking. So people are jaywalking at night and just lack of visibility, especially with the rain that we've had the last couple of months. So I think that kind of, data and analysis is really interesting and is helping us to start to work better. So I'm not sure if you want to go through all of this open data. I have some more pieces I was going to talk about with open data, talking a little bit more about some of the data analytics projects. I guess one question for you all, would it be helpful to go through this, or would you rather just open it to discussion?
And will you make these available that can you send out to us?
You're on my laptop.
Yeah.
Yeah. Already done. We're going to post it on our website.
I did like that slide you just had up with the bullfish.
The examples there? Yeah.
So,
okay.
So was streamlined through some, you know, any improvement would be parks maintenance, like even just like for getting this building, if I wanted to reserve it, it's a major hassle. It's still paper, or last time I tried, it was a major paper-based system. I haven't tried lately, but you know, you can't just go and click, I want this room, this date, like you can if you're going to reserve a hotel room, unless they've changed it. You know, and plus they always throw up that major insurance hurdle that's ridiculous. They should just get rid of that. But, you know, I mean, there's a lot of room for improvement.
Yeah.
And it looks like you guys are looking at it, and the Bloomberg best practices sharing thing.
Yeah.
You know,
looks like all these that you got up there are all about problems. You're trying to get data to see what the problem is so you can fix it. You should have another list of things that what's good about San Jose. You know, someplace have some kind of data that shows how great San Jose is, you know, compared to Cupertino or Palo Alto or I'd like to see that. Palo Alto, I know, has got a great thing on trees, and they actually put little signs on their trees telling you what kind of tree it is.
Yeah.
And little things like that, I think, really make a big difference to a city, especially if you want to, you know, have people move to your city or businesses want to move to your city. But I've been trying to find someplace on the computer that tells me the, you know, 20 great things about San Jose compared to the other cities. I can't find it.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe we don't have anything good about it. That's why it's not up there.
It's
very possible that we don't have anything good.
I think you're absolutely right. So. I think you're absolutely right. And one of the things we've been talking a lot about is this, like, we in business speak, we call it branding, right? Because we are doing all this cool stuff, but somehow it gets lost in translation.
I like to see that, you know, someplace on your data list here, you know, branding or something about what. Let's make a list of why San Jose is better than Palo Alto and Cupertino and Los Gatos, or cities that just surround us, you know. Yeah.
Yeah. And one of the cool things that
you're taking notes on this.
Yeah, you know,
it's recorded.
Okay. All right. Okay. I'm just checking.
The city hall infrastructure that is using old computer equipment that hasn't been updated since '08, and it needs to be updated because there's people rapidly scribbling on paper rather than trying to use their stuff. I'm on a commission, and I don't get the electronic data that I need for the meeting until it's mailed to me. From Thursday to Tuesday, and the meeting is on a Thursday, right after the Tuesday, and I get like 50 pages to understand to deal with that condition.
Yeah, and I think this has been a persistent problem across City Hall, and there actually has been a significant and now recent investment in the upgrade of our CRM system, so literally none of the systems across the departments talk to each other.
Right.
So now they can talk to each other. That doesn't mean that they can now do all of these predictive analytics really easily, because there still is silos across our city departments where they might literally have different addresses, right, for the same property. And so we're going through a process of cleaning that up. And so, you know, I think those two things together and trying to really, you know, digitize is happening now. And you're right that we need to try and accelerate that as quickly as possible.
Well, what's your system for you? Salesforce? SAP?
I don't know what they were using before.
It's all different depending on the department.
Okay.
Yeah, it's really, you know, it's a challenge.
So one thing on the illegal dumping, it'd be nice if maybe a sixth department was added. Maybe they're already part of it, but Caltrans, right? Because it seems like that's where a lot of dumping occurs. People just throw it in the Caltrans property, and so it seems like there needs to be close coordination there somehow.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know if they work on that illegal dumping.
Yeah. Why don't you find out why people are doing illegal dumping first, besides trying to find out where they dump? Why are they dumping? I'm trying to fix that problem, okay? Why are they dumping? And fix it.
That might be the answer.
Yeah, the garbage.
Right? What do you think?
The garbage contracts don't provide for
something.
It.
I don't know. I don't know why. I know there's dumping problems, but I don't know why. Fix the problem.
Yeah.
Fix it. Then you can say it sounds like better than somebody else. Maybe.
Well, and I think the point on you know, fixing a problem and not just using technology for like fancy stuff, you know, I think is an important one, and it's part of the philosophy that we have is like, you know, building technology that meets a real need or solves a specific problem.
I just like to throw out another part of the innovation, which I hope your area is doing, isn't just on technology, but innovating how our cities work together. Because right now, it seems that San Jose, I'm just looking at border cities right now, but when they need to work together, it's very cagey. They're not very supportive of each other, other than superficially and politically politely. But deep down, they really, cities don't seem to really care about each other very much, and they seem to be really just taking care of their own interests. And what they're missing is the interests are the community at large, which involves multiple cities and multiple neighborhoods in multiple areas. It doesn't really matter what the border says.
Yeah.
And it's especially this intersection down here, Winchester and Stevens Creek, where you have, I mean, even within San Jose itself, where you have districts competing for resources, where at the intersection of Stevens Creek and Winchester, you have District 1 on one side, District 6 on the other side, and Santa Clara to the north. You don't have anybody with any kind of control or any kind of vision. Right down to the urban village that is bordering on the south side of Stevens Creek and part of Valley Fair and has nothing to do with Santa Clara. For some of us, it's really frustrating to see that we don't have a collaborative city government, and it seems to be that there's no way to overcome that unless we try and do that, but inherently it's not working. So my ask is that you guys also look at how to innovate collaborative efforts with other cities, so it's not like you're trying to take from them to get tax revenue in your city, or you're not trying to take this project for your city, but to look at the overall region as a whole.
Yeah, and I think that's right, that a lot of the issues here are regional. Traffic is a regional issue, it's not a city issue. And, you know, I think I obviously can't solve all of those problems, but I'll speak from my personal philosophy. And I'm not from San Jose. I'm a transplant. And so coming here, you know, externally, it also doesn't make sense to me. And so I personally am, you know, I'll be going up to San Francisco, and I'll be working with the chief innovation officer there to see what they're doing, what we can learn together. You know, I met with some council members from, like, Mountain View. And so I think there's for my part, and I think for the people that I work with on my team, is there's an openness and collaboration and figuring out, you know, what the right answer is for citizens. But I won't say that that it's not challenging, and there's a lot of history there.
So tying in your little show here, and Kirk's before you. So a couple of screens back, you were talking about bringing up the skill levels of, I think it was 400 people you put on there. And then one before, Kirk was talking about in the United States, 50% of the patents are done right here in San Jose. So one, why don't we try to get like a second office, a patent office in San Jose, and then two, you tie an innovation center right next to it. So that, because I have friends that have ideas, but they're kind of nervous of, where do I go, who do I talk to, how do I get
it? It's right in the city hall.
Yeah, it's right in the city
hall. It's already there?
It just opened up a couple months ago.
Yeah.
Right downtown in the
United States by all right.
So
we just did it.
So wait a minute. Is there, does the city provide help in education on how to get a patent? Or does the patent office do that by itself?
The patent does
it by itself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think there's a program there.
By itself.
And you should do research on what else you have there to see if there's
Holy moly.
Yeah, but it just opened up a couple months ago.
It's there. It's just exciting.
4th Street makes it seem all.
Yeah. But another thing we don't do a good job of promoting, right?
Yeah.
Like that's
what
cool.
Yeah.
Not doing it very well.
Yeah. Are there questions?
Whereabouts are you from, anyway?
I grew up half in Arizona, half in Maryland, but I've been
I've been a bit of a nomad side, I think.
Yeah. What was your impression as an outsider of San Jose?
I mean, I was, you know, I came here before I took this job. I came here one day before I took the job.
Really?
Yeah, and I really love the city. I mean, it's beautiful, it's diverse, you've got super smart people, and, you know, given sort of the political climate we're in, I just thought, this is part of the America I want to be part of.
Good. There you go, there's your tag.
There you go.
Part of the America you want to be. And you're a millennial.
You could be the poster child.
No, no, I'm not. I'm a Generation X.
Oh, really?
Other questions?
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah,
thank you. So much.
Thank you. Yeah, Christina is next, and there's no, we actually don't have any, I'll just blank that out.
Yeah, I printed it out for you, so you have something to do. So first, I just want to apologize, we're transitioning from innovation to CEQA, which is probably the least innovative thing ever. So I also want to preface it with, Kurt and I decided to do this, just first have a snapshot of CEQA before we get into other meetings or we dive really deep into the issues that have been brought up in various EIRs and addendums that I've seen, you know, on the city website, and I've read through a lot of your comments in regards to different projects. So this is really just an overview. What's the process? What's the larger framework? So a little bit of my previous work with CEQA. So I worked at the Oakland City Attorney's Office, and I really got to see when, you know, the planning department was doing it wrong, essentially. So we worked with the planning department to really hone in when they reused EIRs, which is possible with a supplemental or an addendum EIR. So that's something we'll get, you know, into in a later meeting. But I really just wanted all of you to understand what's the timeline, what's the process, and also importantly, where these projects that are happening in District 1 or nearby, where they are throughout the, you know, the process and the timeline. So first, the EIR, so that's the heart of CEQA. So the Environmental Impact Report, that's really what drives the legislation. It's where all of the issues are. It's where all of, you know, the discussion about what's the environmental effect, you know, how do we mitigate them, how do we prevent them from happening when we have new development or a new project. So that's kind of where I started the timeline, and that's kind of where you start. You think, okay, let's, you know, the city gets an application. So I don't know if some of you have seen on Nextdoor, but the city just got the application for the Garden City site today. So we posted about that. And if you have questions, you know, feel free to call the office. And
the EIR just got released today?
No, the application for the project was just filed with the city. Okay. So we just received it. It's hot off the press. I think the paper was even still warm when they dropped it off. So the city gets an application, and then they look at it and they think, okay, where is this going to fall in CEQA? So they do an initial review, and they look at, is it going to be an EIR? Is it going to be one of these exceptions? So sometimes it's not even a project, and you don't even have to go through the whole process. So that's what you were talking about with
Google
broadband, so okay. I'm going to use that.
But they still wrote like a 225-page document to get there, right?
Yeah, well, that's to cover their own,
yeah.
You fill in the blank.
Okay.
So that's a negative declaration. So you're essentially saying nothing is going to be affected in the environment by this project. So you still have to, you know, write something up. You have to file it. But the beautiful thing is, and what you said, is that you can actually reuse that. So say further down the line, you know, another broadband service comes into play, they can look at that document and reference what was said in there. So it's really one of CEQA's very few attempts of streamlining the process is reusing, you know, negative declarations and EIRs and whatnot. So you can go that route. You can also go to the mitigated negative declaration. So that essentially says, yes, there are environmental effects as a result of this project. And project is also very broad. defined under CEQA as a general plan amendment, creation of a general plan, like Envision 2040, a specific plan. It can be a just, you know, what you initially think of, a new housing development. It's really anytime you change the land. So that's, the definition is very broad. So the city will then, you know, after they do their initial review, okay, well, it has effects. It has environmental effects, but we can actually mitigate them to a point where it doesn't have a significant effect on the environment. So that's where we are with CBS. And also, just as far as you know, individual questions that you have about projects, I have on the third page a question sheet for you to write out, because I know it's, I don't want to waste a lot of time getting into specifics tonight about individual projects, but I know, you know, it's very warranted to have questions about specific projects within this process, so feel free to email me. But as far as CVS, you know, it was decided, okay, well, there's going to be a change to the land, there's going to be effects, but they're going to be mitigated to a point where it's not going to have this significant effect.
Which CVS are you talking about?
So that's on here.
Pharmacy, you know, the old Safeway, CVS.
Okay, so
is that the one you're talking about, or are you talking about the
Keto in Saratoga? Yeah, where Rose's Donuts
is. Oh, that one. Oh,
yeah, okay.
Oh, that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I should have.
No, that's okay. That. Yeah, so it's just, you're using it as an example.
Yeah, I'm using it as an example. So they, you know, because there's, I'll just briefly summarize. Because there's, you know, what, Jared, like five other commercial sites there. They're taking all of those down and they're putting up one CVS. And of course, there's, you know, you can look at how that's going to affect, and we can get into the nitty gritty, but their analysis was that's actually going to be a decrease in use. They're actually mitigating some, you know, contaminants and toxic things that were in the soil from an old gas station. So instead of doing a full EIR, it just got shuffled through to a mitigated negative declaration, is what it's called.
Basically, because it's obvious that their change of use is drastically less impactful than what's currently there now.
Yeah, so it's tough because it's, I think where it's tricky is the significant threshold. So it's really understanding within each project what significant means. And CEQA and the regulations, they don't really come out with a specific threshold. So you get into transportation where they have level of service, which basically counts how many cars are going to be added to that location. So that's one of the areas where there actually, you know, is somewhat of a threshold. But usually significant is kind of this gray area where the consultants in the city can decide, you know, when is it going to reach here? When is it going to reach significant? So I think in the future meetings, I think it'd be really helpful to dive into that and look at examples of when things were deemed significant.
And specifically around that, a lot of times we'll see in an EIR as a response, it'll say significant unavoidable impact and it's still okay.
Mm-hmm.
Or a comment is made by somebody and it says, you know, noted. Or commenters' comments, you know, comments noted, or something like that. But there's no actual follow-on. So if maybe in the future we get into a deeper dive, we can cover those types of frustrating responses that we hear. We spend time going through documents and getting marginal responses at best sometimes. So,
yeah, and I think that's really tough to look at and to understand the process, especially when it's kind of changing for each project. And, you know, it may be helpful to look at and how to read an analysis, so that instead of reading, you know, page after page after page, you can kind of hone in on those areas that are really important. So maybe that's something that would be helpful to everyone. Yes.
I'm curious about your going from 6 to 1 on CVS. Is that, you said that there's less usage. Is that like foot traffic, or that's less revenue for the city?
That's a good question. Thank you for clarifying. So that's transportation, right? So that's that goes all back to that level of service threshold. So in a future meeting, if you want to use that one as an example, we can look at that, because that's you know, that's a good example of a mitigated negative declaration. So within that context, and when I'm talking about decreasing impact, that's within technology. So that's a kind of a good, actually, first, let me go over initial meeting. So three, we're under EIR. So say the city decides, you know, oh no, our initial meeting is actually going to be a lot of significant environmental impacts. So if you think of Villar, the project on Winchester in District 6, you know, you can look at that project and you can be like, you know what, I think that's going to reach significant. So the city sometimes will just jump, you know, right to filing a notice of preparation and saying, and I'm not saying that's going to happen with this project, but they can jump right to a notice of preparation and say, we're going to do an EIR. They notify other agencies that will work with them, and those agencies will comment, so whether it's Department of Transportation or Environmental Protection or different agencies within the city, they'll send out a letter to interested, you know, residents, like, you know, perhaps this organization or our office, you know, they'll send out their notice of preparation. And this is also all posted on the website. So there's a link on the bottom, and I recognize that's kind of hard to follow that link on a piece of paper. So if I can also send this out via email, but you can also just kind of Google San Jose EIR process, and it will give you a list of all the timelines and the steps. Yeah.
What is the legal area that they need to notify the residents or the owners of the property within? How big, far an area do they have to notify them?
Well, that's a good question. Under CEQA, there's not really a requirement for that.
Really?
Yeah, so that's within a project application. They'll have a 1,000 feet
so
radius.
The city has its own policy that relates to notification, so for significant projects, it's 1,000 feet, and then for smaller ones, it can be 500 feet. Depending on how, you know, how significant the project is, but that's a city policy. So generally, it's 1,000 feet.
It's not CEQA. It's not at the state level. They don't have specific requirements outlining where it is. And also, you bring up a good point in that CEQA. It's really just, you know, the state law, and under the state law, they'll have regulations that kind of get more specific. And then you have all of this case law that helps to really define the process as well. So, you know, this is really just scratching the surface. So every little box has various exceptions.
It took 3 years for ours to go from 1 to 2.
Yeah.
And on the 23rd, it will be approved or not approved by the council.
And that's also
alone with just a wrench.
Right.
And through this whole process. Took us 3 years.
And that's also something to consider, you know, in recognizing that the process takes time. So under the city timeline, it's approximately 1 year, but they can file for extensions based on, you know, certain issues that pop up, or, you know, as we get to number four, the scoping meeting. So perhaps there's more issues that come up within that meeting, and they, you know, they think, oh no, we have to address these additional concerns. Then that's when the timeline kind of extends and can go up to 3 years. So that can either be a good thing.
Who's invited to the scoping meeting?
So we're going to talk to that next.
Okay.
So after the city notifies agencies and notifies various departments, they'll have an initial meeting or a scoping meeting. So there's two different types of scoping meetings within CEQA. So there's the official scoping meeting that's required when you work with different agencies. So the planning department in San Jose, that's the lead agency that kind of takes control and brings this process to the end. But they work with a lot of different agencies. So when you have all those agencies, CEQA says, you know what, you all have to sit down and you have to talk to each other and figure out what are going to be the major issues with this project, what are going to be the environmental effects. So that's one type of scoping. And then there's another informal scoping meeting, which CEQA says is recommended, but it's not required. So that's the scoping meeting that I think you all be most familiar with. So that's like Santana West, there was a scoping meeting. So planning will do that when there's a lot of interest in a project, when the project is very large, when it's going to change the use drastically. So they'll hold a meeting, and they'll notify the community, you know, on their website. They'll notify, you know, various council members and try to get that information out and invite residents. So that's when I think it's really important for the community to be involved, because that's when you help to set the scope and the guidelines of what's going to be studied. So the reserve project, you know, they actually weren't going to study impact on local streets, but because that was brought up in the within public feedback and comments, they actually decided after the draft EIR, you know what, we're going to actually study that. So I think, you know, scoping and providing comments on draft EIRs is very valuable. As much as it's frustrating maybe not to get the response that you want, because it is still noted, and they still, you know, consider that in the final EIR or the final process.
One of the things that was brought up last meeting, Councilor Oliverio was here and talked about the Volar project specifically, that the EIR was started, or they're going to have a scoping meeting after it. Could you clarify? I mean, it seems like this order is different than what was shared.
Yeah, and that's the catalyst of this, right? Was that comment? So we just talked to planning, and they said they are going to plan a scoping meeting for that project.
But it wasn't started yet.
It hadn't started.
It's not started.
So just to be clear, we just want to make sure that it has not started yet.
Yeah.
No. That process.
Great.
Because that was.
And you can always go to the city's webpage. There's an active EIR on the webpage, and that lists every active EIR in the city. So anything that's happening will always be on that webpage. So if you ever have a question, you can. And there's a completed EIR on the webpage too. Look at ones that are good.
And is Santana West on that list even though the EIR hasn't completed yet, the draft?
It's still active.
It's active.
It's in this process.
It's in progress.
Got it.
To do the draft, right, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so yeah, it's on here. Mm-hmm. So that website will be very helpful to you. And just a little sidebar, Jared had a great idea of starting a map of listing all the development projects that are happening in District 1, and I know Steve is doing that for Winchester, so we've been working on that, and maybe there's an opportunity to also just kind of note where it is in the process, so we can keep you notified when you really need public input. So thank Jared for that.
And you know, make sure you and Ken are working closely together, because Ken has done such an awesome job. The front page of the NAC's website has got probably two dozen little pin marks from Google, which shows everything that's going on, either talked about or active. So it's really,
yeah, we'll have to.
Yeah, I can share that with you.
Yeah.
Okay.
The format is really, it's hard because if it's small, everything's kind of jumbled together, but as soon as you zoom in, it all spreads out, and you can click on any one of those pins.
When you hover over the pin, does it expand out and tell you?
It gives you the detail.
Okay. Yeah, it's excellent. I mean, so go to the front page of the website. Another action for you guys. Go home and check out the NAC website.
Lots of homework. Innovation homework. So after they have the initial meeting and the scoping meeting, which again isn't required by CEQA, but planning often does it, they'll huddle back together and they'll put together a draft EIR. So that's where we're kind of waiting with Santana West. And once that draft EIR is released, they'll send out another notification, which, you know, will appear on their website. And then again, it kicks into that public comment period. Sometimes they hold meetings, in that process. But they're not required to under CEQA. And then they get these public comments, they read through them, and the city is actually required to respond to all of the comments that address significant impacts. So they will respond to those concerns, and they'll note them in the EIR. So they'll update the draft EIR with those responses, and they'll address why or why not they, you know, agreed to consider them, or maybe why they didn't decide to, you know, listen to your suggestion. So they have to know the reason why as well. So that's where that's where a lot of the turmoil is, right? It's, you know, understanding what significant is, understanding their comments, and, you know, even, you know, they do a great job of explaining it, but the language, a lot of it is really tricky to understand and how it all comes together.
Because there are translators available if you're asked ahead of time, in case you aren't having people who don't speak English.
Okay. Well, maybe you need to
speak English. Yeah.
They don't speak English.
Yeah, it's very difficult. And then after that, they look at the feasibility of these alternatives, which is another source of a lot of litigation in court cases. Is, okay, well, we understand that there are significant effects, and you listed these alternatives, which is a requirement by CEQA. So they have to list alternatives. And then there's, you know, the understanding of why did you choose this one over the other. So they have to explain that as well. But again, you know, you run into this grave threshold, that little bit of wiggle room. So that's where a lot of the case law fills in that gray area. So the feasibility section is also really important because you're looking at those alternatives and because you're kind of refining the EIR and deciding, you know, exactly how you're going to handle these effects. And then, finally, you get to the point where planning decides, this is our final EIR. Here it is, we're going to recommend it to our decision makers, and we'll go through that process, and that usually goes, you know, in the same way as the project approval. So if you look at city council meetings, you'll see, you know, EIR approval or mitigated negative declaration. So they're kind of being approved at the same time.
Every council item on the agenda also has a CEQA part, and it'll say, like, not a project or a project. So because a lot of things aren't projects, and if they're not a project, they don't go to the CEQA, but everything is reviewed for whether or not, you know, it qualifies or not. So.
Yeah, so if you ever have questions about that language as well, let me know. So this is, you know, basically the snapshot of the timeline. And again, like mitigated negative declaration, that also gets approved by decision makers. And so does, you know, negative declaration or what Jared said, when it's not even a project. So all of that gets pushed down the chain of command. Until it hits final approval, and then that gets registered with the state. So they actually have to file that and register that. And then this is where you run into, you know, the law. So you run into court cases that say, you know what, I don't think you properly analyzed alternatives, or I don't think your threshold for significant was enough. So that's where you get the years of litigation and people doing this every day and making lots of money. And also, something I didn't know is a lot of the analysis isn't really done internally by the city, especially with really large EIRs. It's done by consultants. So in the CEQA language, they actually say, you know, when they talk about what significant means, safer transportation, you know, they say they rely on the expertise of the internal group or whoever is managing that process. So those consultants, those people that do this every day for that particular area, you know, say transportation or contamination or wildlife, you know, they're really also helping to drive the ball and create this final EIR. So the city on their website, they have a list of consultants that they work with. So you can kind of do a little back research if you're ever curious about who's involved in that process. And also the documents that draft EIR, they'll have the, you know, the heading of who the consultants were that actually completed that part. So I have a question page for you. So I know this is a lot of information, and, you know, next steps for Winchester NAC in exploring this is really looking at where you have concerns or questions within this broad framework and diving in and really analyzing it and figuring out, you know, how to best make sense of this process. So I've heard a few concerns already. So really looking at significant threshold, especially in regards to transportation, and also looking at, you know, reading the documents and how to make best sense of them and really what parts to focus on. So I have two.
So it seems like most of these CEQAs are required when there's a project like a building going to be built or something like that. Chappie recently sent out something about the reserve project, and he sort of mentioned reasons why he is in favor of it. And one of them is that some money will be collected to help offset the, or to help support somehow, probably use one more, the new off-ramp onto Winchester from 280. And the way I was reading it, I was like, man, that sounds like it's a fait accompli. And it hasn't, you know, last time around it got killed because not everybody is necessarily in support of dumping out all those cars onto Winchester, even though the prevailing wisdom from the planners is that everybody's going to get off there and only turn right. You know, go towards Valley Fair, which is really taking the Valley Fair problem that exists at Stevens Creek, and they say that in 10 years that thing they just put in is all going to be obsolete. But it's just kind of moving it around the corner over to closer to, you know, where we live. It's like, does that project require a CEQA, or is that, you know, I don't know. When I read that paragraph from Chappie's memo, I was like, wait a minute, it's not a fait accompli. And yes, they may be collecting money, but, you know.
So, the first question I have, yes, that all requires environmental study, and that's what's being done as part of the Santana West environmental review.
But I'm talking about putting the off-ramp in requires its own system.
So, the transportation development policy that we're considering, so we can actually collect transportation impact fees, so you can kind of establish a nexus to say there's an impact of electricity is what they're looking at now. So, nothing's decided if that's going to be what we build, but I think the perspective of the mayor chatting is that this is going forward. We don't have a framework yet established to capture any money from them. So, you know, if they're willing to give a contribution to us, we should be accepting of that. It's not necessarily that it's definitely going to go to that, but that's kind of loosely what it would be, you know, kind of in deemed for. It doesn't mean that that's definitely what it would be. Yeah, no, but we didn't want to miss an opportunity. Once the project's approved, you don't have an opportunity to really collect. So I mean, it's not the done deal, it's not established. That's just sort of as we know it right now, that's, you know, kind of what
okay.
But everything's being studied.
Thank you for clarifying that.
Yeah.
And then also, yes, communication. So also overall speaking, I think maybe looking at what this threshold is for transportation and maybe how and why they came to that conclusion would be helpful. So we can look at that in a future meeting.
But the reason I brought up communication is that our experience was that we have 30,000 people in mobile homes in San Jose, and we could not reach more than 10 or 15. Maybe we had 70 in one EIR meeting, but a lot are from our park, and a lot are not from the other parks. They haven't been notified, because the primary communication is either email or get on the website. And a lot of these people, their families, they're low income, they're different languages, they are not communicating. At one point in time, I insisted that they send out a card. And what they did was they put gobbledygook on it. Nobody could have understood what the meeting was about. They had a day and a time, and it was a nice yellow card. I said, great, you got a card, you got some attention. But that was the only card. We've had 3 meetings since then, and they've not been notified. So that's the thing. We're having the final call, vote on the 23rd, and I can't reach anybody in any of the other mobile home parks or have housing or anybody deal with that. So that's an issue. You're going to talk residents.
Last question over here.
based on your definitions on the back of the sheet, can I summarize this chart here that basically if it goes over to the right side on the negative, that means that basically there aren't a lot of environmental effects, and it's when you have a major impact upon the environment, that's when you would have to go the EIR route. Is that
exactly
correct?
Yep. Okay. Yep. So, and also, you know, environmental includes a lot of different categories, so I just wrote down a few from that considered in the CVS project. So it's air quality, GHG emissions, hazardous materials, land use, noise, transportation, population, and housing. So it includes a lot of different categories. But yes, that's a very good summary of the chart.
Okay, so I gotta close this. We're at the end of our time. I want to be respectful for everyone's time. Next meeting we have Don Whedon followed by Laura from Spur. If you haven't seen Don, we will get a. I anticipate having a fair amount of people here because we're gonna message this out a little bit stronger from this because it's so critical. I hope you'll join us next time or someone from your office, because the principles that he shares are so critical to understanding, at least from a data perspective, especially if you're in the data world. And whether what he's talking about is accurate or not accurate is also important, because if it's accurate, then we're in a world of chaos that I'm not sure we know how to get to, or we haven't data to make those decisions yet. And if it's not accurate, then we'd like to know why it's not accurate, if it's not. But it's a very common sense approach on how he presents the information. And then Spur, so this is from the county level, what's happening around us, and Spur is going to take us hopefully down to a more local level from how we can try and do something a little bit more actively in our own community. And we're going to close, but there's one I realized early on I did not get to something on the list. It was right before here. We talked about the Volar update. We didn't get to talk about WAG, that's fine. But something about homelessness I think is very important that we at least bring up and acknowledge that's happening in our community right now. It's happening along the freeways. I think we see it between the easements between what Caltrans has right now. It's becoming an issue in the Lona neighborhood. Specifically, I've seen Daphne post. It's probably happening in other neighborhoods. I don't know specifically, but there's been actual break-ins to people's homes. Someone's had a heart attack. There's home invasion from homeless. Cars are being broken into. And I hope that the city, back to the innovation, I didn't get to ask this to Shireen originally. I hope that part of the innovation is how can we treat this as a crisis to actually take action in an innovative way. Whether it's, if this was like a tsunami, we have like 18 units coming down to deal with something. But it feels like we're not dealing with this as a community. Homelessness specifically and the housing crisis in general is a separate thing, but specifically the homeless, which,
I'll give you a report from my side of things, because I have a business on Moore Park, and my business and half a dozen other businesses are very much impacted by the homeless issue. They're occupying the tunnel that connects South Monroe, Moore Park, over to Santana Park. Some of the businesses definitely are affected with sales tax revenue because people aren't going there anymore. But they're running those orange extension cords, plugging into the business. They're using the water from the freeway sprinkler system. I mean, we've seen microwaves, TVs, computers.
Yeah. And there's a waste issue as well. It's a toxic.
Human waste. And also they're going over the ramps. And the cars, the cars aren't expecting that somebody's going to be going over the ramp. The car goes from 50 miles an hour off of 280 southbound to go to Highway 17 toward Los Gatos. And there's people, running over the ramp. There's been three fires so far right next to the buildings. They fix the fence. Caltrans fixes the fence. Sometimes later that afternoon, the fence is already down. And then it's just happening in the last 2 or 3 weeks. So it's a big issue over us. Our side, they did an abatement today.
Right here.
And we don't know. It was about 25 or 30 people. You can see the tents on both sides of the tunnel.
Yeah. So where do they go?
I mean, you chase them away from there. Where do they go?
Well, hopefully they all go to Eden and.
It's a crisis that I
know, but what if you push them from point A, where do they go?
Yeah,
they go to point B.
Then
you flush them from
the Protestant city, goes it? Because they flushed them out of the jungle.
Nobody's winning the game here.
They flushed them out of the jungle in 2014.
Yeah, exactly. As soon as the jungle was closed down,
and what
a great job I did. I cleaned up the jungle. Yeah. Okay. Now it's all nice and clean.
That's fine.
Yeah.